2004. For more information, visit PacificaRadioArchives.org.
It really scares me when I think about the number of recordings in a collection that's 40,000 tapes that might not be playable anymore. And that is really scary to me because we're losing, you know, our history. We're losing our history, the history, you know, of our country, and we're losing the history of our stations. We're losing the history of community radio. We're losing on so many different levels. You know, I think we have this assumption that we're just going to open that box and throw it on a deck and that it's going to play, but that's, we can't depend upon that. We really need to physically get it off, put it on a machine, see how it plays, see what the signal is, and get it transferred as soon as possible. And that's the job we have to do. Otherwise, we're not going to have the recordings, and a lot of people ahead of us will not have those recordings.
Please join us for the Pacifica Radio Archive's third annual one-day fun drive marathon, airing on your Pacifica radio station December 2nd, 2004.
Many thanks to the Pacifica Archive and Brian DeShazer. This is KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCFM, Fresno. Time now is 1 minute after 2 p.m. About Health is up now.
Good health and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Mike Lenore. Today's program will feature a focus on sexual health for men, the complete guide, a book written by Dr. Richard Spark. Dr. Spark is an associate clinical professor of medicine at Harvard University Medical School and director of the Steroid Research Lab in Boston's Beth Israel Medical Center. He's a fellow of the American College of Endocrinology and the American College of Physicians and a member of the Andrology Society, I said it best first, and the Federation of Clinical Research. And he's going to be talking with us about his book, Sexual Health for Men, From Potency to Fertility, Alternative Medicines to Viagra, Hormones, and the Prostate, the authoritative book for men of all ages. And maybe he'll weigh in a little bit on the steroid controversy facing American athletes today. So, Dr. Spark, welcome to our program.
Thank you, Mike.
Always a reason for people to write a book. Why did you decide to write this one?
Well, I had been interested in the subject for many years. In 1980, I wrote an article called Impotence is Not Always Psychogenic. Up until that time, the teaching in medical schools was that men who had sexual problems always had problems of an emotional nature. And when we started to look into physical causes of emotional problems, we found many causes. Among them, problems with hormone production, low testosterone, low thyroid problems, and other problems. And one thing led to another, and I started to look into this, and it became an area of research. And with the development of further understanding of chemistry, we've developed into the rage of Viagra, et cetera.
Right.
So we know a great deal more about male sexual health than we did in 1980.
Well, you know, it's interesting that, you know, when you started this concept of maybe there's something else going on here, it was kind of an in the closet type of medical issue. I mean, I remember doing programs on male impotence many years ago, and it was always thought of as something, you just didn't talk about, especially in certain cultures. And now, hey, nobody's afraid to talk about it now.
Well, I think a considerable amount of that is due to the fact that Viagra has made it possible to talk about this. Now, would it be easy for you if I got on a regular line instead of handheld line? Can you hear me now?
I can hear you. It's just a little feedback, and it may be a little bit easier if you got on a regular line.
Well, I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to move over to a regular phone. Hold on one second.
All right. This is production in live production. This is an exciting piece.
Does that make a difference?
Yeah, it makes a tremendous difference. Thank you.
Okay, good.
All right, Dr. Richard Sparks, Sexual Health for Men is the book. We're talking about why he wrote this book, and we're talking about the visibility, the enhanced visibility of impotence now as an issue that people can talk about. I think Viagra's had a lot to do with that and an awful lot of...
I think that's true. I mean, what it did initially, if you think about it, if you go back to when Viagra came out, it was the courage of Bob Dole. Former Vice President Dole, who said that he had had some prostate surgery and was left with a sexual problem after the prostate surgery. and took the Viagra, and he no longer had the problem. And then he encouraged people to talk about this.
But so we don't get kind of focused in just one issue, but there are lots of sexual health issues for men other than just the impotence issue, aren't there, that you talk about in your book?
Yes, well, there are many things that we talk about. We talk about the issues related to impotence. We talk about the whole issue related to males' hormones, which are much in the news now with the athletes, and Balco Lab is in your area. And there are a variety of different things that are touched on in the book. So it's basically a book for men about a lot of problems that concern them, and it's written in a way that's designed to attract the average reader. It's not a medical textbook.
You know,
and it is written to help people who have problems, who want to have answers.
There's so many issues related to sex. I mean, in fact, I think when many people think about sexual dysfunction or sex in general, they really think of focusing on orgasm. But really, there are a whole number of steps in any kind of a sexual encounter. Can you go through some of those so that people have really a perspective?
There are a variety of different steps that men go through before they actually have sex. First, they have to be attracted to somebody that they want to have sex with. And this attraction is registered in the brain. And the brain sends a signal to the spinal cord. And the spinal cord transmits that signal to the genital area. And that starts blood flowing into the penis so that the penis can convert from a limp to an erect organ. And this occurs very spontaneously in men when they are young. It occurs less spontaneously in men as they increase in years. And fortunately, there is a backup system, a reflex erection system, that allows men to be stimulated to an erection by genital touching. And this sets up another signal from the spinal cord to allow the erection to occur.
Now, when you first started in endocrinology and certainly started looking at this whole issue, there wasn't a lot of interest. But we've learned a lot recently about male sexuality, haven't we?
Yes, we certainly have. We have learned a great deal about men and the way they function sexually, and the major input has been understanding the basic chemistry that allows the erection to occur in the first place and allows it to be enhanced by a product like Viagra and the newer drugs out on the market now, Levitra and Cialis, all of which work to enable a man who's having difficulty to have an erection to have an erection in response to sexual stimulation.
For the purpose of our readers, where do these drugs work in the process?
Well, they work because there's of some very clever chemistry within the body, within the tissue of the penis. And what that is a transmission of some chemicals that start the flow of blood into the penis. These chemicals can be enhanced by Viagra, Levitra, or Cialis. And once the blood flow starts and an erection starts, the chemicals within the penis enhance that to see to it that the erection remains firm and rigid for as long as the man wants to have sexual intercourse.
I understood that impotence was a major problem among men, but I had no idea it was as common as it is. What's the frequency of impotence?
Well, the frequency is fairly high. It starts in most men about age 40, about 40% of men at age 40 will start to experience one or more sexual failures. And then with each increasing decade, it goes up about 10%. So men can count on experiencing some sexual failures, so that 50% at age 50, 60% at age 60, 70% at age 70, and so on. And this seems to be true across the board. And it happens for many men, and it's a source of great shame and embarrassment to them, and unfortunately need not be, because we have adequate ways to address it and treat it. So men who are suffering from any problem area certainly can be taken care of effectively with any of the new medications.
What are some of the medical conditions that lead to impotency?
Well, there are many medical conditions that lead to this. For example, some of the common medical conditions are hypertension, high blood pressure. There's a high incidence of sexual problems with high blood pressure. There is also a problem with diabetes, a common problem in which diabetic men tend to have a greater problem with sexual function earlier on than they would if they were not diabetic. In addition, there are many medications that we use to treat high blood pressure that can cause problems in this sphere. Also, curiously, such as depression, also cause individuals to have difficulty with sexual function. And unfortunately, the medication depression will be effective in alleviating depression, but have as a side effect causing more sexual problems. So it becomes very, very difficult. There are a whole range of different medical issues that men face. From my standpoint as an endocrinologist, men as they age have low testosterone values, and when testosterone levels get low, they tend to have difficulty with sexual function as well. And for these men, treatment involves not just the use of a Viagra-like medication, but frequently the only treatment that's needed is to give them back a medication that will allow testosterone levels to normalize.
Our special guest is Dr. Richard Sparks. He's the author of Sexual Health for Men, The Complete Guide. From Potency to Fertility, Alternative Medicines to Viagra, Hormones, and the Prostate, the authoritative book for men of all ages. If you want to join us in the 510 area code, our number is 848-4425, 848-4425. And just because we're talking about a book that's, that describes sexual health for men doesn't mean women can't join us as well. For questions about this issue, 848-4425, KPFA, KPFB, KFCF in Fresno. Doctor, you know, when most, Sparks, when most people talk about sexual health, they really are focusing really on erection.
Yes.
But there are a number of dysfunctions beyond the erection that we need to pay attention to. What are some of those, and what do we know about them?
Well, some men can get an erection, and they can have sex, but they have a problem with ejaculating either too early, too late, or not at all. And these two are problems that can be dealt with, but yet it's one of those things that you have to go to your physician, speak to him, and describe the problems. Often what we find is that people who have problems in the sexual sphere are so embarrassed about them that they won't discuss them with anybody. And when they don't discuss them with anybody, the problems tend to fester and they get a little bit worse. And when they finally do come out and start to talk about them, it becomes even more difficult to treat them. But we encourage our men with sexual problems to come forward, speak to the doctor. The doctor has now a variety of different treatments to help him, help the man. And once that man can be helped, they're usually very, very grateful.
Well, Doctor, I've got a bunch of questions for you, but let's stop and take a few of our listeners. Let's start with Robert in Silicon Valley. You're on About Health.
Yes, Dr. Lenore, can you hear me?
I can hear you now, yes, sir.
Okay, great. Just have a quick question. The impact of hypertensive medicine on sexual function.
Yes.
Because there's a lot of new medications that are now claiming that a lot of new medications do not cause the same problems that a lot of the earlier types of medications have. But it's very hard to find that type of information.
Well, if you want that type of information, it's in the book. The book has a whole chapter on medications that cause sexual dysfunction and medications that are less likely to cause them. And you're 100% right. The caller is 100% right that many of the medications that are used to treat high blood pressure cause men to have sexual dysfunction. Now, it is not across the board 100% that if you take the medication, you're guaranteed to have a sexual problem. But some of the most common original medications, like hydrochlorothiazide, were notorious for causing sexual problems. Fortunately, there are other medications like that, diuretics, that don't cause the same sort of problems. There are a whole new range of medications that are used to lower blood pressure in men that can be used without disrupting sexual function. And they fall in line of medications like the so-called ACE inhibitors, which are usually very effective. The so-called calcium channel blockers, those tend not to cause problems with men with sexual dysfunction. Your doctor knows all about these medications, and he has them at his ready disposal. So if you're having trouble with one type of antihypertensive medication, the most logical thing is to treat you with another medication that can do the most important thing, that is bring your blood pressure down to where it should be, and two, allow you to have the sexual function that you would like to have.
All right, thank you for that question. 848-4425, the 510 area code is our number. Go to Mike in Concord. You're on About Health.
I'm a young man, and I've been using this stuff called maca just because I like what it does to me. But I don't know if that's going to have any long-term effect on my abilities when I get older. I don't have any particular dysfunction. I just like the kind of herbal superpowers that you can get from. I don't know if you probably talk about it in your book, a number of herbal remedies. And
we do talk about herbal remedies in the book. Tell me the name of the herbal remedy you're using.
Maca, M-A-C-A.
Now, I'm not familiar with that one, but I will double check that and learn about it. There are many herbal remedies that have been used for a long period of time.
This is one that the Mayans used in South America. It's just a root.
It's a root.
Anyway.
Yeah, yohimbine came from a bark of a tree in Africa.
Okay.
And that was supposed to have, and that has actually bona fide properties to help some men with erectile dysfunction. And this is on the market as an over-the-counter medication. As I say, we've got a whole chapter in the book dealing with all the alternative medicines and what they do. I probably have not covered everyone, and I'm sure I'm always going to find somebody else knows about another medication that I don't know about, but I appreciate your letting me know about this.
Well, I just actually wanted to ask you, are there any health concerns with using things as a young man? For when I get older, am I going to become dependent, or am I going to need, I mean, maybe not specifically with this herb, but should I just cool it and rely on my own natural abilities, or is it all right to have a little boost?
Well, I'm a little bit of a loss here, not knowing much about maca to tell you for sure. I can tell you that the only thing that we know that we see our young people get in trouble with is using, for example, narcotics. We have a lot of young men who shut off their ability to make testosterone when they are using methadone or anything in that category. So we have a population of young men who have been opiate addicts for a period of time around methadone programs, and by the time we get to see them, their testosterone levels are barely measurable, and that's because the narcotics actually shut down the system in the brain that stimulates the pituitary to stimulate the testicle to make testosterone. So that's the only thing that we see in our young men right now that causes problems of that nature. The major other thing that we have problems with is cigarette smoking. Cigarette smoking damages the areas within the penile tissue that must expand to allow a man to have an erection. And I believe in California about 10 years ago, maybe longer, they ran an ad called Still Think Smoking Sexy, where they had these very fancy, tuxedoed, well-dressed men walking around at a party with cigarettes in their mouth, and all the cigarettes were limp to drive home the message that smoking was dangerous to your health in general and particularly to your sexual function. So this is something that's well known. These are two commonly used products. And the other one is alcohol. All of us have a drink every now and then, and nobody has any problems. If you drink enough, you will damage your ability to continue to have sexual function. And the question is when you find the point to stop. Most men can drink reasonably, sensibly, and have no problem with sexual function, but those that overdo it sooner or later run into problems in this area.
A couple things. You know, anybody who's got emails consistently getting these advertisements for herbal enhancement of sexual potency, are there some, of course, my impression is always that a lot of them have more psychosomatic effects than they do medical effects. But am I wrong about that?
Well, there are a lot of herbals mentioned that are supposed to enhance sexual function, and a lot of them are very well sold. And the reason that they keep getting proposed is they are on word of mouth. One person tries some product, they say it works, and he encourages a friend to try it, and they say it works. And I understand how that's being done. But in medicine, as you know, the way we know for sure that something works is to take men with a problem and give some of the men the medicine or the herb, and some other men a placebo, something that looks like it but has nothing in it. And you look and you see how many men respond who took the placebo and how many men who respond who took the active ingredient. For example, when Viagra was first on the market, some men took Viagra and some men took a placebo. 24% of the men who took placebo insisted that their sexual response was improved when they were on the placebo. So there is about 25% of men can have a placebo response to almost any medication. And that's enough to keep things going in terms of sales on an herbal level. If you want to get something through the FDA, however, and have it approved as a real drug to treat people, then it has to be something that's done on a comparing that drug to placebo, much as Viagra was done with placebo.
But are there some that you could recommend that, I mean, categories of alternative therapy that actually may have some value?
It's been popular for a long period of time. I mentioned Yohimbine before. There are several others that are promoted for this reason and tend to be more or less word of mouth rather than proven. For example, in another area, not in sexual function, in the area of prostate health, we've got a whole chapter on prostate health, there's a medication that's available over the counter called Saw Palmetto that does make it easier for men to urinate. And that's been compared to placebo, and there's no question that it works. And it is a very, very effective medication for some individuals who are getting up at night frequently and urinating 3 to 4 times a night. They take the Saw Palmetto and they tend to have less frequent urination. This is a very, very popular medication now, and virtually all of the men we see sooner or later tell us that they have been on it or tried it at one particular time.
Our special guest, Dr. Richard Spark, our book, Sexual Health for Men. Always your involvement in our program makes it work. Our number is 510-848-4425. That's 510-848-4425. Let's go to EK in East Palo Alto. You're on About Health.
Yes, good afternoon, Dr. Lenore and Dr. Spark. One area of persons who might have problems are people with spinal cord injury.
Yes.
And I'm one of those, and I've seen and heard of things called the injection erection and splints and Viagra. The other one that you mentioned was...
There are two new ones, one called Levitra and one called Cialis.
What's the last one?
Cialis.
They're all advertised on television now. Levitra ad is an ad you see with Mike Ditka, and the Cialis ad is you see a middle-aged couple in a tub,
right,
and the fact that they can have sexual function after they take these medications.
Right. The question
Let me get back to the spinal cord injury and the prostate injection. The process of converting the penis from a limp to a rigid state, sometimes it's impaired in men who've had spinal cord injuries. It depends at what level the injury is. But for some men, Viagra and Levitra, as well as Cialis, does work well in allowing men to have an erection again.
The question that I have...
But he's got a specific question, yes, Doctor.
The question that I have is, of all of the methods that you know of, which is the least, has the least side effects and is the most efficacious or effective?
Well, that's going to vary from men to men, because there are some men who will do quite well with the Viagra tablet alone, and others will not. So it has to be tried on a regular basis. The one that works consistently in men with a spinal cord injury to allow them to have an erection is the intrapenile injection. But this has a problem associated with it, especially in men with spinal cord injury, because they can have a problem referred to as priapism, where the penis gets erect and does not become unerect after the man has sex.
Right.
That's a problem that has to be taken care of. That becomes a medical emergency.
Right. Okay, well, many thanks for your information.
All right, thank you once again for these very intelligent questions, and always learn something from the questions that he can ask. The interesting thing about these, what is the most common side effect from these
from the medication, you mean the Viagra type of medication?
Right.
The most common side effect from all the medications is headache.
Okay.
Because the medications cause an erection by causing blood vessels to dilate in the penis, and the same blood vessel can dilate in the head, and then when that happens, you men can get a headache.
All right, let's go to Hayward. Talk to Bill. You're on About Health.
Hi. I hope my radio isn't too loud.
No, everything sounds fine right now.
Well, I was in Japan in 1966, and they had a substance they sold, a sexual stimulant, had Yohimbe,
yes,
and strychnine nitrate were the two ingredients. And they sold the same products for men and women, the very same product. And I'd like to hear your comments on that. And also, I wonder how you feel about, some people use drugs as an aphrodisiac, but I find marijuana is a stimulant.
Yes.
And lastly, I'm a little curious as to the actual purpose of Viagra in older men, and I'm an older man, I'm 65, but I can see it for young people who want to reproduce, but what purpose is it for older folks? As your body is starting to tell you to shut down, and you're not supposed to be out there being able to reproduce.
You better speak for yourself, Bill.
I'll take my answer on the air.
He asked several interesting questions. One was about the yohimbine combined with strychnine. I don't think that's available in this country because the strychnine is too toxic for some men. It can cause significant vascular problems. And I think the FDA has been quite firm about getting that off the market. The issue with respect to older men wanting to have sex and when maybe it's time to shut down really is dependent upon the older man and his sexual partner. If the two of them have enjoyed sex for many years and they still would like to enjoy sex, then that the purpose of the medication like Viagra or these other medications is to allow them to do that. It's to recapture a function that they once enjoyed and they would like to enjoy again. That's really basically what it is. It's not related to reproduction at all. Viagra allows you to get an erection, but it does not has nothing to do with your capability of reproducing. Only insofar as when you have an erection, you will have an ejaculation and you are capable of impregnating somebody. But other than that, the major rationale for Viagra was to improve sexual function in men, mainly erectile function. It does not improve sexual desire, by the way. None of these drugs really improve sexual desire. What they really do is to improve and make it easy for a man to have an erection when he wants an erection. Let me just speak briefly about the difference between the new medications, the Levitra and the Cialis. Levitra and Viagra are really similar in molecule. They're similar molecule structures, and they're basically the same chemical. The Cialis is a different sort of chemical, and it has a different capability that allows it to be effective not for just 4 to 5 hours, as Viagra is. But for men who take Viagra or Levitra, they take the medication, they're told to wait for about an hour, and then if they want to have sex within the next 4 to 5 hours, as long as they have some sort of sexual stimulation, they should be able to have an erection and engage in sex. The Cialis works somewhat differently in that the Cialis, you can take a tablet on a Friday and your capability of being stimulated for sexual function persists through the weekend. And indeed, in Europe, this medication is known as the weekend. Further, it is not affected by consumption of modest amount of alcohol or fatty foods, whereas Viagra and Levitra are to a greater extent. So these are somewhat different molecules and somewhat different medications, And for men who are having sexual difficulty, they've worked out quite well as treatments to allow them to recapture and enjoy the sexual function that was once a vibrant part of their lives.
Do any of these drugs have any effect on women?
The Viagra has been tried in women, and frankly, the problem is we know more about sexual function in men than we know about in women. In women, there are two types of problems. One is a lack of sexual desire, and the other is a lack of sexual arousal. That is, women can desire to have sex, but they can't be readily aroused. The Viagra was tried for a while to see if it would help women who were having this particular problem, lack of arousal. And it turned out, after many, many years, not to be effective at all. It turned out that even though it does the same thing by increasing blood flow into the female genital areas, particularly into the clitoris, it doesn't turn out to be much better than a placebo in allowing women who have this problem with a lack of sexual arousal to recapture that arousal.
What about what about the other drugs?
The other drugs have not been studied extensively in women at the present time. Both Levitra and Cialis have been studied primarily in men, and all of the data are available only in men. So the Pfizer company, who had tried to use Viagra in women, went through several years. It must have been about almost as long as they had the Viagra on the market for men, about 5 years, and only this year did they abandon the use of its use in women. They stopped trying to see if they could get this approved for use in women because it turned out not to be effective.
Sexual Health for Men is our book. Dr. Richard Spark is our guest. He is the clinical professor of medicine at Harvard, the associate clinical professor of medicine at Harvard University, and the director of the Steroid Research Lab at Boston's Beth Israel Medical Center. If you want to join us, 510 area code 848-4425. A lot of interest in this topic, so be patient. Let's go to Bobby in San Jose. You're on About Health.
Yeah, just one comment, Dr. Lenora, about the herbs and erectile dysfunction. I read in many instances, if a person is on hypertensive medicine because, you know, of course, they know that impotence is a result of arterial and vernacular constriction in the area, the pelvic region, but many times you have to increase the blood flow there. So if you're hypertensive and you're hypertensive medication, sometimes they don't recommend even taking a lot of the natural herbs can cause your blood pressure to go up. So I was wondering if the doctor covers that in his book.
Well, there are some, or I don't know which herb you're referring to, there's some herbs that can affect blood pressure, but they tend not to be a problem for men the way that the antihypertensive medications are a problem for men. But the trouble with the herbs is that some of them, like the saw palmetto, which we talked about with prostate problems, work quite well. For prostate problems, the ohimbine can work in a select group of men with erectile dysfunction, difficulty in erection. But many of the other herbs haven't been studied that well, so we can say with confidence that we know that they do or do not work effectively. With respect to hypertension, years ago there was an herb on the market called reserpine, one of the first antihypertensive medications available, made from the Rauwolfia root. And this medication was an effective blood pressure-lowering agent, and it was, for many years, the only medication that we could use to treat blood pressure, to treat high blood pressure, but unfortunately had significant sexual side effects for a variety of different reasons. One, it has slowed down blood flow into the penile area, and two, it raised the level of certain other hormones in the brain that prevented men from having adequate sexual function.
All right, thank you, Dave, for that comment. Let's go to Abu in Fremont. You're on About Health.
Okay, I don't have a question as such, but I just got something to share with you doctors and maybe the listeners out there. You know, from an Islamic point of view, we've been taught by some traditional scholars that in order to maintain your sexual potency, one of the reasons why these days the potency is so low is because of the thinning of the sperm. Now, one of the reasons that in Islam, like the teachings of Islam, where people are encouraged, especially men, to have to lower the gaze and avoid lustful gazes, you know, this actually helps and saves the person from turning the sperm. So this is one thing, one way which today, unfortunately, everybody out there is just like looking around with all sort of gazes. So this is one of the reasons why the sperm actually turns out. And as the traditional doctors even tell us, Islamic doctors, they tell us that by maintaining or controlling your gaze, you actually control your desires. By controlling your desires, you're eventually adding strength to your sperm. And eventually it'll give you good performance when you, of course, with your legally wedded wife or whatever. So this is one of the suggestions I'd like to just share with you people out there, that this is an everyday thing. You know, everybody, it's something that's practical, and it will have a definite effect on you if you can maintain and control the gaze. That was one thing. And another which I may add also was, you know, in the Islamic culture, I mean, they encourage to lengthen the beard or to keep the beard. And recently, actually, there was a scientific finding, maybe the doctor knows about it, where there was some findings of, you know, some veins or some nerves from the face connected to the penis directly. And by the shaving action, actually, it damages that what you call vein or nerve, and it eventually weakens the sperm, and again, it results in poor potency or poor sexual function. So just two things I want to add and just to share with you guys out there.
All right, thanks. Abu. You want to comment on that, Doctor?
Well, thank you for sharing that. Every culture looks at this in a different way. I don't know of any connection of nerves in the face to the genital area, so I can't comment on that intelligently. About the averting of the gaze is, again, traditional in Islam, and I recognize that. I'm not sure that the men who don't avert the gaze have a more of a problem than the men who do. So I can't really comment about any issue related to his practice in Islam. Whatever he feels that works for him and maintains his potency and his fertility, I think is excellent. I would just like to leave it there.
Does frequency thin out sperm?
Does frequency thin out sperm? No, it used to be thought that if you ejaculated by either having sexual intercourse or masturbating frequency, that would diminish the quality of your sperm. And it turns out that this is probably not true because of the fact that we have one study recently done with the medication Cialis. We looked at sperm count and sperm capability in men who took that medication every day for 90 days. And at the end of 90 days, their sperm count, as well as their testosterone production, was identical. So there was no damage to their ability to function from a sexual or reproductive standpoint if they were ejaculating on a daily basis.
All right, thank you for that question. 848-4425 is our number. Sexual health for men is our topic. Our special guest, Dr. Richard Sparks. We're talking about the whole issue of sexual health, potency to fertility. If you want to join us, 848-4425. Let's go to Lisa. You're on About Health. Hi, Lisa.
I commend you. You always get the most knowledgeable people. It's very interesting. You asked a question about products for women, and I have found something lately that is quite helpful. It's produced by Warner Healthcare, and it's called Avlimil, Avlimil. You take one tablet a day, and it's herbal. Dr. Sparks mentioned that the issues for women are different.
Well, they are, and Avlimil has been widely touted as being effective for women. And there is an organization that I belong to that really is looking into sexual problems of women, and often they speak of the benefits of the Avlimil. As to my knowledge, the drug has not been involved in the sort of double-blind, placebo-controlled study that would give it the same sort of credibility that we have with Viagra. although it is widely used and it is largely used by word, the popularity is shared by word of mouth. Some woman tries it, finds that it works very well for her, shares it with a friend, they try it, and they continue to work out well. So that's fine for these women. For what we would need, or what the FDA would need to approve it as an FDA-approved drug for this particular reason, for sexual problems in women, would be a more complicated and rigorous trial than we currently have. But right now, there, as far as I know, there do not appear to be any problems with its use, and many women seem to be happy with it.
All right, thank you very much for that contribution, Lisa. We appreciate you joining us. Let's go to John in Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Thank you for taking my call, doctor. I have type 2 diabetes and don't have a blood flow problem at all, but have a valve problem. The flow, the blood goes in, but the valve doesn't shut and stay shut when I need it.
Yes. Okay, well, that's a problem that's known as a fancy term called venous incompetence. And what it means is that the blood flows into the penile tissue, but ordinarily, for a fully rigid erection, it should flow in, and the pressure within the penis should be tight enough so that it chokes off the valves of the veins that drain the penis. The penis, those veins are called tiny little emissary veins. Sometimes there are individuals who can be operated on for that to see if they can strengthen that area, but more recently, the success with the drugs like Viagra and Levitra and Cialis have been rather substantial, particularly in this population. Have you had the chance to try any of those drugs?
Yes, I've tried Viagra, but I just got a headache, and that was that.
Well, I'm sorry you got the headache. That is the side effect associated with it. But I would try the Levitra and or the Cialis. Speak to your doctor about them.
Okay.
Both of those are available. And both of those we've had very good success with those in diabetics. As I mentioned at the top of the show, diabetics are particularly prone to having sexual problems.
Right.
And, but we don't have it, in all honesty, we don't have the same degree of success that we have with people without diabetes. But the diabetics, especially when they use the Viagra in the high dose, the 100 milligram dose, or the Cialis or the Levitra in the 20 milligram dose, seem to do quite well with this. And I would chat with your doctor and see if a trial of this would be right for you. He knows whether this is a medication you could tolerate, and if he can, he could give you some samples. You could try a couple of pills and see how well you do.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you for that question. Let's now go to Tom in Los Gatos. You're on About Health.
Yes, doctor, thank you for taking my call. I have a kind of unique situation in that I'm a psychologist, and I also have been struggling with depression for almost 10 years and have tried a variety of antidepressants. And since that time, my sex drive is almost non-existent, and I have two concerns, maybe two questions associated with that. One is, what can I do besides quitting antidepressants altogether? And secondly, is there any concern that I might need to have about atrophy to my sexual organs or my sexual response mechanism or what have you? And I'll be happy to take my question off the air.
That's a very good question. People who are depressed have significant problem with sexual function, and as I mentioned, one of the problems is when we treat their depression, we can alleviate the depression, but some of the antidepressants that we use seem to have sexual side effects, and they sort of wipe out libido, as your caller described. I think one of the things you can try is to try a different type of antidepressant. The one antidepressant that has been most widely touted as having the least sexual side effects is Wellbutrin. And it might be worthwhile to see if whoever's prescribing the antidepressants for you feels that that sort of medication would be right for you. That seems to be the one that works best for our patients who become depressed on the other types of antidepressants.
All right, thank you very much for that question. Let's go to Steve in San Francisco. You're on About Health.
Okay, good afternoon. Thank you for answering my question. And I would like to know what causes, what is the cause, and what herbs or drugs or techniques, what they call premature ejaculation. You know, some people last 5 minutes, some people half hour, but what advice could you give?
Well, what causes premature ejaculation is a release of a nerve impulse during the course of sexual intercourse, so that the sphincter that is holding the semen in all of a sudden squirts out. And that can be sometimes benefited by, curiously, it's a good segue to the last question, by some antidepressant medication. Some of the medication, like trazodone, has as a sexual, as a side effect, delayed ejaculation. So that men who have some problem with premature ejaculation can take a small dose of trazodone before they want to have sex. And that usually, at least after several occasions of using it, can allow them to retain the semen before they ejaculate it. It works out very, very nicely in a lot of our patients.
Is that something you get across over the...
No, that's a prescription medication. You have to speak to your doctor about that.
Trazodone, huh?
T-R-A-Z-A-D-O-N-E. It's not approved for that particular use. It's not one of the indications listed, but one of the side effects listed is delayed ejaculation. So what's a bane to one man is a boon to another, and it's something that you might want to discuss with your physician and see if he feels that that particular medication is right for you.
All right, thank you for that question. Sexual Health for Men is the book, The Complete Guide. Dr. Richard Sparks, who is an associate professor of medicine, clinical professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School and the director of Steroid Research Lab in Boston's Beth Israel Medical Center. And, doctor, we'd love to sit in and have you talk a bit about steroids, but I got so many people on the line, we just have to keep rolling in this direction. So let's go to George in Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Yeah, hi, doctor. Thanks for taking the call. I just want to share with you some findings I've come across in some readings and see what you think about it. I read in some Taoist literature practiced by Taoist priests from way back in China that they would have an orgasm, but yet they would not ejaculate by pressing on a point at the base of the penis. And I just want to see what your thoughts are on that, whether you've heard of it before, and any comments you might make.
Yeah, this is a technique that has been used for individuals who have had problems with sexual function. Actually, a technique developed with Masters and Johnson that's also discussed in the book. And it is a relaxation response that is used to try to allow men to be more comfortable having sex, and then at the last minute before they ejaculate, to have the partner squeeze the base of the penis to prevent the ejaculate from coming through and to maintain the erection. This is it. This has to be done with a willing partner, and the partner has to be agile enough to be able to get the hand around the base of the penis during the process of intercourse and squeeze on it to prevent the ejaculate from coming through. And this will block the flow of semen out of the penile area. Is that what you were referring to?
Exactly. And I was wondering if whether or not the retention of the semen would actually prolong the sexual potency of the man, since there's no depletion of the semen.
Well, it's very interesting. We tend to associate the potency with the volume of the ejaculate, et cetera, and the timing of the ejaculate. There's a difference between the ejaculation and the potency. The nerves that control ejaculation and the nerves that control potency are different sorts of nerves. And they
one of the questions we're frequently asked is, if you ejaculate often, will you lose or be in a position to maintain your potency? And they're totally unrelated to one another in that regard. That is, if a man ejaculates frequently, it does not affect his potency, and nor does it weaken any other aspect of his reproductive capability. Is this what you were asking? I'm not sure.
Thank you very much.
All right, thank you very much for that question. Let's go to Jason and Hayward. You're on About Health.
Yeah, this is Jason. Can you hear me?
No, we can hear you.
Okay, I don't have a question. I just want to say something to correct you guys up there. You heard of Viagra Stands and Niagara Falls?
Well, yeah, you know, it sounds good. Go ahead.
So,
we can't, Jason, we can't hear you.
Just wanted to correct you guys up with Viagra Stands and Niagara Falls.
Right. We need that kind of injection in our program. So let's just keep moving. Let's go to Jim. Let's go next to Jim in Palo Alto. You're on About Health.
Yes, thank you. I'm calling. I have sort of a different experience. I've been managing a priapism since my mid-20s. I don't know if it's connected, but in my early 20s, I had two spinal fusions in the lumbar area. And like I said, I've been managing priapisms since my mid-20s, including one really severe bout, which required a stent for to drill a hole and so forth. And then I wound up impotent for 6 months, fully recovered. But I still manage priapism and more erection than is desirable, and also some discomfort with erection. I've seen the urologists. It seems to be a pretty mysterious kind of syndrome. I've also been talked about Peyronie's disease or Peyronie's syndrome as part of it. And I wondered if you had any input on what priapism is, how to manage it, whether or not it's possible that the spinal fusions are playing a role in me experiencing priapisms, and any information you might have. I'll take my answer off air. Thank you.
Okay. The spinal fusion, if it's something that related to the bones of the spine, should not affect the priapism unless the nerves trapped in that area were affected. And that, without knowing more about the details of the nature of the surgery that you had, I really couldn't comment on it. The Peyronie's disease is different. The priapism, for the readers listeners who don't know this, priapism is an erection that lasts for a prolonged period of time and does not go away after ejaculation. Under normal circumstances, when men have sex, they get an erection and ejaculate, and after the ejaculation, the penis returns to its normal state, which it has at rest. In men who have priapism, the penis does not do that. It remains swollen and engorged for a period of time, and if it goes over 4 hours, it's referred to as priapism. And this is a medical emergency and requires men to get to the emergency ward for the sort of treatment that the patient described. Peyronie's disease is a totally different condition. That's a condition in which there is scarring of the lining of the shaft of the penis, and the penis itself bends during an erection. So it can take a U-shape or an S-shape. And when it does that, it makes it difficult to have sexual intercourse, because instead of the straight rod-like structure that the penis should be, there is a curve or a bend at the end, and it's difficult for the couples to get into a position where they can have sex satisfactorily. There may be some new medications coming along for Peyronie's disease. As a matter of fact, I was in Phoenix yesterday, and we were talking about that, but that's not yet ready to be released at the present time. It's still in investigational stages, but from a research standpoint, it looks very, very exciting. We'll have to wait for about a year or two before we know about it.
Doctor, just a minute that we have remaining or so, what's your take on the whole issue of steroids in sports? I mean, yesterday I heard an interview with a guy who said it's really no big deal and doesn't do that big a deal. What position do you take on it?
Well, the steroids in sports,
you got to use the term. When we're talking about steroids, we're talking about anabolic steroids.
Right.
There are a lot of drugs that are steroids. Estrogen's a steroid.
Right.
Cortisone is a steroid. But we're talking about anabolic steroids.
Right. We understand the difference.
Yeah. Anabolic, a muscle-building steroid.
Right.
And there's no question that if you take large amounts of anabolic steroids, you can build muscle and improve strength. And this has been a major industry in among athletes who have become anabolic steroid abusers.
Right.
But they have to take very large doses of anabolic steroids to achieve this effect. And all of the athletes who do this have their own regimen on stacking, of trying one steroid after another and building one on top of another and then going off. And eventually, they will build up muscle strength. The basic problem now is there are so many tests that are done for these athletes after competition that can detect these steroids that it becomes very, very difficult for them to use them without getting caught.
In 30 seconds or so, are they as dangerous as people feel they are?
They are dangerous when used in the doses that anabolic steroids use them in. They are very dangerous when they're taken by mouth. Many of the ones that are taken by mouth cause damage to the liver, occasionally can cause liver cancer. When the stuff is taken by injection, it can cause problems with lipid problems, increased cardiovascular disease. Every now and then we see a bodybuilder who drops dead at age 24 of a heart attack.
All right, Doc, we got to wind down. Sexual health for men is a topic, an excellent book. We didn't touch the surface. Dr. Sparks, you can tell by the popularity of the program, you really hit on a subject of great interest, and so we'd like to thank you for joining us on this program. Most of all, I'd like to thank Ranjita Geisler, and thank you for joining us on today's edition of About Health, especially all the men. Remember, health is our biggest asset. Thank you for joining us. We'll talk again next week.
About Health does air every Monday from 2 to 3 p.m. here on 94.1 KPFA. Free Speech Radio News is up next after these announcements.
Is the presidential election really over? Many people in Ohio don't think so, and they came from all over their state to present testimony this past weekend about how they believe the election was irregular and perhaps stolen. Tune in to KPFA this Wednesday, November 17th, from 10 a.m. until 1 p.m., and hear Ohio citizens describe their experiences on Election Day. And we'll have an update on the ongoing count of provisional ballots and recounted ballots in Ohio. That's Wednesday, November 17th, 10 a.m. to 1 p.m., a special on the Ohio election and beyond, with me, Larry Bensky, here on KPFA.
KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF, Fresno.
Have you received your ballot for the KPFA local station board? Ballots are due at the station no later than Friday, November 29th, 2004.
If you haven't received your ballot in the mail, call toll-free 1-877-217-6928, extension 205.
Members who have donated at least $25 or volunteered 3 hours between September 1st, 2003 and August 31st, 2004 are eligible to vote in the election.
Candidate statements for all 19 listener member and 5 staff member candidates appear on the KPFA Elections website at election.kpfa.org.
Here are 3 statements from candidates running for the KPFA Local Station Board.
KPFA Local Station Board candidate Tom Blanks.
My name is Tom Blanks. I'm requesting your vote to represent you on the local station board in its important work to keep the hard-won democracy growing. KPFA has provided an evolving vision with commitment to diversity, pacifism, and the arts. You have listened, you have volunteered, and you have pledged. Many of you have spoken with me as I have volunteered at the station fund drives and events for over 15 years. In my 35 years as a teacher and my 25 years of working on nonprofit boards committed to social justice and the arts, I have acquired the ability to mobilize others to work collaboratively for a win-win outcome. I will bring my sense of humor and my joy at finding common ground. I will work hard to preserve this valuable resource for KPFA's expanding community of present and future listeners. Thank you for voting for Tom Blanks.
KPFA Local Station Board candidate, Jane Jackson.
I'm Jane Jackson. I'm running as a member of the new station board for KPFA, and I would very much like your vote. I'm an original KPFA listener, and I've spent my entire life as a civil rights and human rights activist. I have great faith in the youth of today, and I ask for your support to be a mentor to them so that we teach each other so that this station stays with us.